जय गोपी जय वल्लभा गिरिवरधारी जय गोपी जय वल्लभा यशोदनंदन व्रज जन रंजन यशोदनंदन व्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरा जय राधा माधव कुंज हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे हरि बोल हरि बोल हरि बोल नित्य गौर हरि बोल जय राधा गोपीनाथ राधा गोपीनाथ राधे जय ललिता विशाखा जय राधा गोपीनाथ राधे जय राधा गोपीनाथ राधे गोपीनाथ राधा राधे जय जगन्नाथ जय जगन्नाथ
ऐश्वर्य अष्टोत्तर श्रेष्ठ मदन दिवाई ग्रेस अभय चरणारविंद भक्ति विदान स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की श्रील भक्ति सिद्धांत सरस्वती गोस्वामी ठाकुर जगद्गुरु श्रील प्रभुपाद की ब्रह्मभक्त गौड़ीय संप्रदाय आचार्य गुरुवर की अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की नामाचार्य श्रीदास ठाकुर की जय प्रेम से कौशल कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत श्री गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद की श्री ललिता विशाखा राधा गोपीनाथ जी की जगन्नाथ बलदेव सुभद्रा महारानी की बोलो श्री वृंदावन धाम की श्री मायापुर धाम की श्री नवद्वीप धाम की पुरुषोत्तम क्षेत्र जगन्नाथपुरी धाम की गंगा माई की जमुना माई की तुलसी देवी की भक्ति देवी की समावेत गौर भक्त वृंद की समावेत गौर भक्त वृंद की ऑल ग्लोरीज टू द सेवन डिवोटीज ऑल ग्लोरीज टू द सेवन डिवोटीज All glories to the seven devotees. All glories to the seven devotees. All glories to Sri Guru and Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Namo Vishnupadaya Krishna Vishthaya Bhutale. Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namini. Namaste Saraswate Devi Gauravani Pucharini. Nirvisesha Shunyavani Pastura Deshkari. Vancha Kalpataro Vestya Vipasindhu Devacha. ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
appeal to the Lord. Today's text is number 35 and I believe 35 36. And 36. It's 36, okay. Because I believe 35 does not have a purport. But I will still read the verse because it's there on the board. Agnir mukham yasya tu jata veda. Please repeat.
36 is on there. Oh, I'm sorry.
36 is. 35 I will just simply read because yesterday we did 34. Jata kriya kanda nimitta janma. अंतःसमुद्रेऽनुपचन स्वधातुं प्रसीदातं न स महाविभूति
Translation by Srila Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Fire which is born for the sake of accepting oblations in ritualistic ceremonies is the mouth of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Fire exists within the depths of the ocean to produce wealth, and fire is also present in the abdomen to digest food and produce various secretions for the maintenance of the body. May that supremely powerful personality of Godhead be pleased with us. Text 36.
Ya chakshura sittanay devayanam.
त्रयीमयो ब्रह्मण एष धिष्ण्याम् द्वारं च मुक्तं मृतं च मृत्युः
प्रसीदतां नः समः विभूतिः या चक्षुरासे तरणे देवयानम् त्रयीमयो ब्रह्मणेश मृत्युः प्रसीदन्तां न स महाविभूतिः
for the demigods.
Trayimayaha.
Trayimayaha.
For the sake of guidance. In Karmakand, Vedic knowledge. Brahmanaha.
Of the supreme truth.
Eshaha.
This.
Nishnyam. The place for realization. Dwaram. Sure. As well as the gateway. Muktehe. For liberation. Amrutam. The path of eternal life. Sure. As well. Mrityuhu. The cause of death. Prasidatam. May he be pleased. Nah. Upon us. Sir, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Mahavibhutihi, the All-Powerful. The Sun God marks the path of liberation. which is called Archirādi Vartmā. He is the chief source for understanding of the Vedas. He is the abode where the absolute truth can be worshipped. He is the gateway to liberation, and he is the source of eternal life as well as the cause of death. The sun god is the eye of the Lord. May the Supreme Lord, who is supremely opulent, be pleased with us. The sun god is considered to be the chief of the demigods. He is also considered to be the demigod who watches the northern side of the universe. He gives help for understanding the Vedas, as confirmed in the Brahma Samhita, chapter 5, verse number 52. Ya chakshuvesha savita sakala grihanam raja samasta sura murti ashesha tejaha yasya agyaha bhramati samvrita kala chakro govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami. The sun, full of infinite effulgence, is the king of all planets and the image of the good soul. The sun is like the eye of the Supreme Lord. I adore the Primal Lord Govinda, in pursuance of whose order the sun performs his journey. Mounting the wheel of time, the sun is actually the eye of the Lord. In the Vedic mantras, it is said that unless the Supreme Personality of Godhead sees, no one can see. Unless there is no sunlight, no living entity or any planet can see. Therefore, the sun is considered to be the eye of the Supreme Lord. That is confirmed here by the words Yat Chakshur Asita, and in the Brahma Samhita by the words Yat Chakshur Esha Savita. The word Savita means sun god. Om Jnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakhaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Vancha Kalpatarupyascha Kripa Sindhuvyascha Patitanam Pavaneyo Vaishnaveyo Namo Namaha. Narayanam Namaskrityam Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jayo Dhiraye Shrinvanta Svakatha Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtanam Ridiyantasta Bhadrani Vidunoti Suhrutsatam Nashta Prayeshu Bhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavati Uttama Shloke Bhakti Bhagavati Naishtiki Nigama Kalpa Taro Galitam Phalam Shukamukha Dravamrutam Samyutam Pibata Bhagavatam Rasamalayam Muraha Rasika Bhuvi Bhavuka Aradhyo Bhagavan Vrajesha Tanayas Taddham Vrindavanam Ramya Kachid Upasana Vrajuvadu Varyena Taya Kalpita Srimad Bhagavata Purana Yamalam Prema Pumatho Mahan Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu Matayidam Nayatraya Graha Paraham. Grantrashya Bhagavatam Ki
Jaya.
So first of all, I would offer my obeisances, hundreds of obeisances, to all the Vaishnavas assembled here, to Srila Prabhupada disciples, senior Vaishnavas present, to His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada, and all the assembled Vaishnavas. May the words that emanate from my mouth be pleasing to His Divine Grace, to all the Vaishnavas and the lordships. If there are any mistakes, I ask for forgiveness.
And if it gives any one of us some insight or pleasure, it is all due to the glories of Guru and Gauranga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. So I will read the translation once more time. The sun god marks the path of liberation, which is called Archira Adi Vartma. He is the chief source of our understanding of the Vedas. He is the abode where the absolute truth can be worshipped, and he is the gateway to liberation. He is the source of eternal life as well as the cause of death. The sun god is the eye of the Lord. May the Supreme Lord, who is supremely opulent, be pleased with us. So before we go into today's verse, I would like to kind of briefly summarize so far what has happened in this chapter. In this 8th canto of chapter 5 entitled The Demigod's Appeal to the Lord, the summary is that Lord Brahma is describing, or rather Sukadeva Goswami and Sukta Goswami, they are describing to Parikshit Maharaj mainly three subject matters. The first subject matter being the fifth and sixth Manus. The second subject matter being the curse of Durvasa Rishi. And the third subject matter being is the actual prayers that are being offered by Lord Brahma and the other demigods. So, in reference to the Manus, in this particular chapter, the description is given of the fifth Manu known as Raivat Manu. And in the Raivat Manu's presence, or in his time period, millennium, the Lord appeared as Lord Vaikuntha. And the next Manu, being Chakshusha Manu, the Lord appeared as Lord Ajit or Kurmadev. Chakshusha Manu is the sixth Manu. There are actually 14 Manvantars or 14 Manus in one day of Lord Brahma. And one day of Lord Brahma is equivalent to, we will round it up, 400,000 years of Kali Yuga, plus the previous age, Dwapar, 800,000, plus the previous age, Treta Yuga, 1.2 million years, plus the previous age, Satya Yuga, which is 1.6. So total number of one cycle of Satya, Treta, Dwapar, Kali Yuga is approximately 4 million years. And when you multiply that by 1,000, 4 million multiplied by 1,000 is equal to Brahma's one day. It's a long number. Many zeros. And within that one day, 14 Manvantars or 14 Manus appear. The first one being Swayambhu Manu, and now we are describing in this chapter the fifth and sixth Manus, Raivat Manu and Chakshusha Manu. And this presently, as we speak, right now it is the time period of the seventh Manu, which is going on, and he is known as Vaivasvata Manu. So we can approximately say, because he is the seventh Manu, our Lord Brahma of this particular Brahman universal system, his half a day has passed. Just half a day. And like that, if we just simply calculate 14 Manus in one day, 420 in one month of Lord Brahma, 5,040 in one year Manus of Lord Brahma. Our Srila Prabhupada's beloved Gurudev, His Divine Grace Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada, wrote a wonderful treatise known as Surya Siddhanta. That is how his name, the adjective of Siddhanta Saraswati, was added to his name. And in that treatise, on astrological treaty, he has actually given a complete description of all the Manus, including their fathers and their forefathers and the tree. It's a lot of painstaking work. Can you imagine 5,040 Manus with their family line that was compiled by a professor? His name was Professor Biman Prasad Dutta at that time, the son of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So after his treatise was accepted in the University of Calcutta, he was given the scholarly title of Saraswati Thakur because of writing this wonderful treatise called Surya Siddhanta. The curse of Durvasa Muni was as follows. The second part of this chapter in the description, the brief description, is that once when Indra was riding high up on his elephant and Durvasa Muni was passing by, and Durvasa Muni had a garland and he wanted to give it to Indra as a blessing, just like sometimes senior Vaishnavas garland us, or we get the garland from the pujari as a blessing. So Durvasa Muni gave the garland, but Indra was kind of, because of his opulence at that time, he had a sense of pride in him. He did not come down from the elephant, but rather he had the elephant take the garland with the trunk, and he did not personally accept it. The elephant, simply he didn't know what to do with it because it's an animal, and he crushed it under his feet. So Durvasa Muni was extremely upset and he was angry, and we all know that out of all the Munis, we have to be very careful of Durvasa Muni. Durvasa Muni gets angry like that. We have known many cases. Does anybody remember another case of his anger on a Vaishnava? Of course, in this case, probably there must be some rightful anger, but we all know the pastime of Amrish Maharaj. Although being a wonderful Vaishnava, he was so upset. Not only upset, he was so upset that he actually created a demon out of his hair and wanted to kill him. That is the condition of Jnanis. The Jnanis, Durvasa Muni is considered a Jnani. Jnanis and Brahmanas have a very difficult time becoming good Vaishnavas. Vaishnavas are already Jnanis, they're already Brahmanas. But a Brahman and a Jnani, they have a lot of pride in them. They get insulted very quickly. They are still fighting on the subtle body level of Pratishtha. Sometimes they are able to give up Kamini and Kanchan. They are able to give up the opposite sex, association of the opposite sex. And sometimes they are even able to give up the association, or meaning the attraction to money, Kanchan, gold. But Pratishtha is extremely hard for them to give up. So due to his anger, Indra, being the king, he was cursed. And since he was cursed, the entire bunch of, a platoon of demigods were also cursed simultaneously to lose their opulence. And because they lost their opulence, now the demigods' opulence means not only wealth, but their opulence is also strength. Strength in fighting the demons. As we know, there are so many cases in the different millenniums that there have been different wars between the demons and the demigods. And one of the great assets that they had is they had opulence because they are actually known as Suras. Sura means one who is a devotee. And the opposite of Sura is Asura. Asura means demons. So Sura means one who is serving the Lord
believing the Lord, but at the same time, they have some mishra. They have some kind of attraction towards opulence. So the Lord is very kind. Them being the servants, He gives them not only the heavenly opulences, but also gives them the different powers. He delegates the powers so that they can help in the universal affairs. Krishna is very kind on His servants. So we have to sometimes be very careful what we ask for. If we ask for opulence and if we ask for material things only, and if we are still devotees of Krishna, Krishna will grant us that. But pure devotional service is extremely difficult to come by, especially if we have other desires. Rupa Goswami says, Anya vilasita shunya, jnana karma anavritam, anukulina Krishna anushilam, tad bhakti uttama. Anya vilasita, all different kinds of material desires should be zero, shunya, including jnana and karma. Ultimately, we should not be interested in jnana and karma either, only to a certain extent so that it brings us to the platform of bhakti. Jnana karma are not bereft of jnana and karma, anavritam. Anukulena Krishna anushilam. What is top bhakti? Top bhakti is whatever is conducive, whatever pleases Krishna, it is uttam bhakti. So, due to the curse, the demigods started, there was a war with the demons, and the demons used some dangerous weapons, including snake weapons, the Bhagavatam describes. There is a weapon, I remember if I'm not wrong, there's a Nagpash weapon that in the son of Ravan, what is his name? Indrajit, he had used to bind Lakshman. Lakshman is Ananta Shesh. And then eventually that Nagpash weapon, it was a fatal hit, and Lakshman swooned. He almost left his body. And that's when we know that Lord Ramachandra ordered Hanuman to bring the Sanjivini from the Himalayas so that he could revive his brother. So that Nagpash weapon is very, very dangerous. Such weapons were used, and because of them being bereft of the opulence of fighting, they lost and they ran hither and thither, and eventually Lord Indra, along with Varun Dev and all the demigods, they came to Lord Brahma, because Brahma being the presiding deity of this particular Brahman, they went to pray to him. So every time there is a problem, the demigods approach Lord Brahma. We know, even during the before Krishna appeared, the atrocities of Kamsa and the other demons under him, the Bhoja dynasty, Jarasandha, and so many other demoniac kings, when their atrocities increased, at that time Bhumi, the personification of Mother Earth, she went to pray to the different demigods, including Lord Shiva and Lord Brahma. And what did Lord Brahma do? Lord Brahma realizes that he himself is not powerful enough sometimes to bring a solution to the problems that the demigods have. So they went to the Kshirsagar, or the milk ocean, headed by Lord Brahma, and prayed to Shirodakshaya Vishnu. And Shirodakshaya Vishnu, it is said that he does not really give darshan, but only Brahma can hear the sound, and he will give the message to Lord Brahma. So it's amazing that the sound vibration, and then Brahma conveys the message of whatever the Lord. So in the case of when the atrocities of Kamsas and the other demoniac kings were there, Shirodakshaya Vishnu said, okay Brahma, I will appear now as my original personality in Vraj, and I request all of you to go ahead and take birth in the Yadu dynasty, in Vrindavan, in Vraj, so that it will enhance the pastimes of Krishna. So, I think that prayers are also called Purusha Sukta. The Purusha Sukta eulogizes the Supreme Lord. So, the previous few verses is something similar, where they try to appease, Lord Brahma and the demigods try to appease and please the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They say that, oh, you are the Supreme Truth. Oh, my dear Lord Krishna.
Sri Sri Radha Gopinath Pradita Vishakha Ji Ki, Nikai Govasundar Ji Ki, Jagannath Baldev Subhadra Maharani Ki.
So the prayers eulogizes Krishna to please Krishna. What are prayers? Prayers basically, if you want to summarize it, doesn't matter whether we are Vaishnavas. A prayer is basically, it has two components. One component is that when we are Aartis. Aartis means, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, four kind of people come to me. Aarti, Artharti, Jnani and Jigyasa. So Aarti is one who is in distress, one who is miserable. So those people go to pray, so that the Lord will remove that miseries. Artharti is one who wants wealth, Jnani one who wants knowledge, and Jigyasu one who is inquisitive. So Krishna already categorizes this. So that's one reason why people go. And then the other reason is also to please Krishna. Krishna is also known in the Bhagavatam as Uttam Shloka. Uttam means choice, topmost. And Shloka means he is eulogized by wonderful verses. So, Lord Brahma and the demigods say that you are the Supreme Truth. Satyam Param Dhigamai. Even Vyasdev, before starting the Srimad Bhagavatam, the actual first verse is also known as Mangalacharan. And the second verse is actually the first verse, chronologically speaking. So then the first verse, Vyasdev says, in the last line, Satyam Param Dhimahi, you are the eternal truth, O Krishna. So same way Brahma and the demigods are there. You are the origin. Lord Brahma also in another millennium, in chapter 5, we have the Brahma Samhita. He says that you are the origin of everything, Sarva Karana Karana. You are the cause of all causes. He says, my dear Lord, O Krishna, you are fully cognizant. You know everything. And also we know by definition, according to most faiths, how do they call God? God is omnipresent, omniscient, and omnipotent. So omniscient means he is all knowledgeable. Again, coming back to Srimad Bhagavatam, the first verse of the Mangalacharan. Om Janmadi Yasya Yato Anvaya Itaratascha Artheshwa Abhigya Swara. Abhigya. Krishna knows everything directly and indirectly. Abhigya Swara. He says, you are omnipresent. Oh dear Krishna, you are present everywhere. And that is the reason one of the names of Krishna is Vishnu. In Sanskrit, the word Vishnu, when we translate it into English, it means all pervading or present, whose presence is there everywhere. My dear Lord Krishna, Lord Brahma prays, you are not visible to everyone. He prays like that because we are all covered by the moods of material nature. Mother Kunti also prays like that in the first chapter, 8th canto in her Kunti prayers. She says, Namasye Purushamadhyam Ishwara Prakrite Param Alaksham Sarva Bhutana Antar Bahir Avastatam. Meaning, Kunti Mata says, Namasye Purushamadhyam, I offer my respectful obeisances unto you, the origin of the Supreme Personality of God. Namasye Purushamadhyam Ishwara Prakrite Param. Oh my dear controller, oh dear Krishna, you are beyond the three modes of material nature. Ishwara Prakrite Param. Alaksham Sarva Bhutanam. You are not visible to everyone. This is the point that Lord Brahma makes in the previous few verses. You are not visible to everyone. Although Antar Bahir Avastitam, although you are situated within as Paramatma and also outside in different forms, you are not visible. So Lord Brahma continues his prayers. He says, your maya is very difficult to surmount. Krishna also says that in the Bhagavad Gita, that maya maya divataya. It's extremely, it's not some anybody's ordinary maya. Maya is mine. And it's extremely different. Therefore, Lord Brahma says that we cannot understand you because of your maya. Again, coming back to the Mangalacharan of Bhagavatam. Muhyanti yat suraya.
the pastimes of Krishna and the interaction of the modes of material nature, they even put the demigods into illusion. Muhyanti yat suraya. So he says, therefore we surrender unto you. And then there are more eulogies. More eulogies come by saying that he is making it very easy for the common man. What is the common man? The easy things that Lord Brahma is saying, that the common man needs water for survival. The previous couple verses, needs water for survival. And basically, O Krishna, the semen, your semen or the perspiration is that water, the life-giving water, is the source of the life-giving water. Then further he eulogizes, he says, the moon is your mind, and it is the source of nutrition to the vegetables and the different grains that we get. Prabhupada mentions in his purport that all the succulent, nice vegetables that we eat, where does that juice come from? That comes from Soma, the moon. I think we discussed that verse yesterday. Then he further eulogizes, which is kind of today's two verses, combined 35 and 36. He says that fire which is born for the sake of accepting oblations. So the fire is basically, that is what you are. You are the fire. Because without the fire, the oblations cannot be accepted, especially in a yajna. And Krishna's mouth is like a fire. So just like when we are putting the offering the ingredients, Om Swaha, Swaha, Swaha. So the different bhoga that we are offering, that signifies, the fire, flame, signifies Krishna's mouth. So here Brahma is saying that, you know, it is you who is the source of the fire. Further he is saying in the same verse that you are the source of digestion, because we have a vrika agni, a digestive fire in every living entity has that. There is a certain temperature that we maintain, especially the mammals or the human beings, about 97 degrees Fahrenheit. And that happens right from birth. Can you imagine that if you had to light one candle, even a small candle, somebody lives, let's say 80, 90 years old, continuously keeping that candle on, how much wax or energy would be required to keep that little fire burning? Constantly, that fire is supplied by Krishna, who is the fire incarnate in our body that helps digestion. If we don't have the fire or the agni, we will not be able to digest food. We will not be able to live properly. And then he further says, in today's verse, Brahma eulogizes by saying that Sun God marks the path of liberation. So, first he is talking about the basic necessities of water. He talks the necessities of the different grains, fruits, vegetables. He talks about the digestive fire. Then the further next few verses, he talks about the wind, etc., the air. So all this, you are the source. And now he's saying the Sun God. Actually, the Sun God is the eyes of Krishna. There are so many different references in the Bhagavatam. In chapter number 2, chapter 6, chapter 4, the eyeballs are like the sun. In canto 2, 9 chapter, verse 34, no value without me. Meaning, if there is no sunlight, there is no value. If there is no Krishna, there is no value. And Brahma Jyoti is the source of the sun. Now, Brahma Jyoti comes from where? Brahma Jyoti is the actual effulgence that is from the body of the transcendental body of Krishna. Not only from Krishna, but the aggregate light from the entire Vaikuntha planets and the entities. Sometimes we forget that 3/4 of this creation is transcendental, spiritual, full of spiritual worlds. Thousands and thousands of Lord Narayanas, Narayana Lokas, and Narsingadeva Bhagavan has his own planet, Varadeva has his own planet, all the different Avatars have their own planet.
then there is Ayodhya, then there is Dwarka, then there is Mathura, and then there is Golok Vrindavan.
And three quarters, that means this is fully inhabited with personalities, with persons.